Hello students, today we are going to discuss about nuclear models. As we know that in atomic nucleus there are protons and neutrons, and we have also studied the properties of the nucleus, where the nuclear forces, that are the strong Yukawa forces, are responsible for binding the protons and neutrons inside the nucleus. Many questions were there which could be answered only by the some models. So the models that were proposed to explain the properties of nucleus were degenerate gas model, collective model, alpha particle model, optical model, liquid drop model, and the shell model. The most important were the liquid drop model and the shell model, who could explain successfully the magic numbers, why alpha and beta particles are emitted during the nuclear transformations, although alpha and beta particles are not inside the nucleus, how could it be there? So these questions were answered by the liquid drop model, and more precisely the questions were answered in the shell model. So today we shall discuss the liquid drop model. So liquid drop model was proposed by Bohr and Wheeler in 1939. They had considered that the nucleus is analogous to a liquid drop, which is an incompressible liquid having a very high density. As in liquid, molecule forces are saturated and they do not depend upon the size, but they depend only on the number of molecules in the liquid. Similarly, the nuclear forces are also saturated forces, and they also depend upon only the molecules or the nucleons in the nucleus and the nucleus. So, what were the assumptions of the liquid drop model? So Bohr and Wheeler said that the nuclei of all the elements are considered to behave like a liquid drop, which is incompressible. It cannot be compressed, and the liquid is very high density. We already know that the density of the nucleus is 10 raised to power 17 kilogram per meter cube. This is a very high density. So the nuclei are considered to be a drop of incompressible liquid of very high density. Second assumption was presumed that in the equilibrium state, the nucleus of an atom remains spherically symmetric under the action of these strong attractive nuclear forces. Similar to the drop of the liquid, which is also spherical due to the surface tension. We know that due to the surface molecules are always under a attractive force, which is in which the inside nucleons or inside molecules are attracting the surface molecules. So the tension, the envelope of the liquid is always spherical in shape due to surface tension. Similarly, the surface of the nucleus is always under a tension due to the inner nucleons, and it also gives it the spherical shape. So that is why the nucleus of the atom remains spherically symmetric under the action of strong attractive nuclear forces. Third assumption was that the density of the nucleus is independent of the size of the nucleus, in the analogous that the liquid density is also independent of the size. So we can see that all the assumptions were similar to the liquid drop. The fourth assumption was that the nucleon of the nucleus moves within a spherical enclosure called the nuclear potential barrier, just like the movement of the molecules of the liquid within a spherical drop of liquid. Since there is a spherical enclosure, no nucleon can simply come out of the nucleus. It has to cross a potential barrier to come out of the nucleus. Similarly, as in the case of liquid, that the molecules in the liquid has to cross a barrier, molecular barriers, to come out or to escape from the liquid drop. So nucleus is having a potential barrier, and the nucleons are facing some enclosure which is called the nuclear potential barrier. The fifth assumption was that the binding energy per nucleon is constant, just as the latent heat of vaporization of the liquid. This means that the energy required by the molecules to change from the liquid state to the vapor state is constant, Similarly, the binding energy per nucleon in the nucleus is also constant. So the binding energy per nucleon in the nucleus was analogous to the latent heat of vaporization, and both these are constant. So these were the assumptions of liquid drop model suggested by Bohrer and Wheeler. So this was the model proposed, and with this model we could calculate the binding energies as well as the mass of the nucleus. So according to these assumptions, we can calculate the semi-empirical mass formula. So semi-empirical mass formula can be calculated. So for this mass of the nucleus, we have the formula that the mass of the nucleus could be calculated by the sum of the proton mass and the neutron masses, and we should subtract the binding energy term. So since some energy, some masses are involved in binding the nucleons, so that binding energy has to be subtracted from the total mass of the nucleons to get the mass of the nucleus. So for that, for the mass, we know the mass of proton, we know the mass of nucleon, neutron, and we know how many protons and how many neutrons are there. But we have, the main question is here to calculate this binding energy involved. So binding energy was dependent upon five contributions: B1, B2, B3, B4, B5. So these five contributions had to be added to calculate the total binding energy of the nucleus. So the very first term, for the very first contribution to the binding energy, came from the volume term. As we know, if we consider a volume of the nucleus, we know there are many number of nucleons. So considering the centermost molecule or the nucleon in the nucleus, the nucleon, the centermost, is surrounded by 12 nucleons with its immediate neighbor. 6 are in the surrounding the centermost nucleon in the XY plane, if we say, and 3 are at the top and 3 are at the bottom. So this gives us 12 nucleons. So if we suppose that there is a binding energy between a pair of nucleon, and we suppose that the binding energy between one pair is U. So the binding energy of one nucleon in one pair of bonding pair will be U by 2. So we have written that each bond energy U is shared by 2 nucleons. So each nucleon will have a binding energy of U by 2. And as we have said now, that each interior nucleon is surrounded by 12 nucleons. So the binding energy for these will be given by individual binding energy U by 2 into 12 is the number of other spheres in which they are in contact. So it gives the binding energy of 6U. So now if we consider the nucleus as having A nucleons. So if it is having A nucleons, one nucleon is having a binding energy of 6U. So A nucleons will have a binding energy of 6AU. So we can see that the binding energy is proportional to the number of nucleons A. So we say that this B1 term is proportional to A. Removing the proportionality sign, we can say that B1 is equal to A1A, where A1 is constant of proportionality, which is constant, and this constant can be calculated using the empirical formulas, where A1 is greater than 0. So the binding energy for the volume energy term B1 is proportional to the number of nucleons. Since it is a energy that is shared between the nucleon, so volume energy term is also called the exchange energy term. So coming to the second contribution, that is the surface energy contribution. In the volume term, we have considered that each nucleon is surrounded by 12 nucleons. But this is not actually the case. The nucleons at the surface is not under the effect of 12 other nucleons. As this is clear in this picture, that if it is a centermost molecule, inner nucleon, then this nucleon is surrounded by 6 nucleons in its sides, and 3 nucleons are at the top and the 3 nucleons are at the bottom. So there are 12 surrounding nucleons. But if we consider the surface nucleon, so the surface nucleon will not be under the effect of 12 neighboring nucleons. It will be only attracted by inner nucleons. There are no outer nucleons or above nucleons. So the surface nucleon is under the effect of less attractive force.
So there has to be a correction applied to the volume binding energy term. So this correction has to be subtracted. So that is why we have written here that the total binding energy is proportional to the volume of the nucleus overestimates the binding energy of surface nucleons. Means it has taken extra contribution for the surface nucleon, and this extra contribution has to be subtracted. So a correction has to be applied. So what we say, since we know that the nuclear surface area is 4 pi r square, and we know that r is equal to r naught a raised to power 1 by 3, as we have already calculated. So if we substitute the value of r in this equation, what we get? The surface area is 4 pi r naught square a raised to power 2 by 3. So the number of the nucleons with fewer than the maximum number of bonds is proportional to a 2 by 3. So this statement means that the surface nucleons are facing lesser bonds as compared to the nucleons which are innermost, and they are having 12 neighboring bonds. So the surface nucleons binding energy is proportional to a raised to power 2 by 3. So this term has to be deducted, it has to be corrected. So there is a negative sign by removing the proportionality sign. So we get that the second contribution of the binding energy, that is B2, is equal to minus A2 into A2 by 3. This is a negative term. So the binding energy term for the surface energy has to be corrected, has to be minus or subtracted. So as we know that each of the system has a tendency to achieve maximum stability, or it has to achieve a configuration which is maximum stable. So we know that the surface area of the sphere is least, and which is having a least surface area has maximum binding energy and maximum stability. So that is why the nucleon takes the shape of a sphere. It does not take the shape of a square or a triangle, since the surface area of square and triangle are larger than the surface area of the sphere. So it has the tendency to approach to a minimum surface area. So minimum surface area is for a sphere. So the nucleons undergoes such a transmutation that it will acquire the shape of a, it will acquire envelope of a sphere. So that is why a sphere has least surface area, and in the absence of external forces, a nucleus must be spherical. It takes a spherical shape for the maximum stable configuration. So we have calculated two terms. The one is the volume energy term and second is the surface energy term. So there is a third term for the binding energy, which comes due to the Coulombic forces. So now we start with the third contribution, that is the contribution due to the Coulomb forces, which is called the Coulomb energy. Since there are protons inside the nucleus and protons are positively charged, so there are Coulombic repulsions due to the protons, and these repulsions are imparting negative binding energies. So we say that the potential energy of the two protons separated by a distance r is given by V is equal to minus E square upon 4 pi epsilon naught into r. So that the two protons is suffering a potential energy, it is having a potential energy of minus E square into 4 pi epsilon naught r. And since there are Z protons in the nucleus, and each proton is making a pair with each other, so there will be how many combination of protons? So there will be ZC2 combinations of such proton pairs. So ZC2 is equivalent to Z into Z minus 1 by 2 proton pairs. So for one proton pair, if it is having a potential energy of minus E square upon 4 pi epsilon naught r, so Z into Z minus 1 by 2 pairs will have a potential energy or binding energy of Z into Z minus 1 by 2 into V. So we can say by substituting the value of V, we have B3 is minus Z into Z minus 1 by 2 E square upon 4 pi epsilon naught into r, where since there are large number of pairs, so we have taken the average value of the distance r to be r average. And the protons, if you assume that the protons are uniformly distributed throughout the nucleus, So the nuclear is having a radius of r. So we can say that this averaged value of the r can be written as 1 by r, or we can say since r is equal to r naught a raised to power 1 by 3, so we can say 1 by r average is proportional to 1 upon a raised to power 1 by 3. So we can say that the binding energy is again a proportional factor to a a 1 by 3 factor. So we can say that B3 is minus A3 Z into Z minus 1 upon A1 by 3. So negative factor means negative sign has come because this binding this binding energy is a repulsive type of binding energy. It is not contributing positive sense. So there is a negative factor because it arises from an effect that opposes the nuclear stability. It is causing repulsions, not attraction. So this factor has to be also subtracted from the total energy. So if we add the three contributions, the total binding energy due to all the three contributions will be given by B is B1 plus B2 plus B3. So putting the terms for B1 is A1A, B2 is minus A2 into A2 by 3, and B3 is minus A3 Z into Z minus 1 upon A raised to power 1 by 3. So taking A common, we get this term, or B upon A, binding energy per nucleon will be given by A1 minus A2 A raised to power minus 1 by 3 minus A3 Z into Z minus 1 into A raised to power minus 4 by 3. So these were the binding energy per nucleon for the three factors. So the next contribution to the binding energy comes from the asymmetric energy term. So this asymmetric energy term contribution is due to the neutron. In the Coulomb energy, the main contribution was due to the proton because for the repulsions, Coulomb energy was arising. But here the asymmetric term is due to the neutrons. As we consider in the lighter nuclei, the number of protons is nearly equal to the number of neutrons. Suppose we consider the case of neon, carbon. So we have the case of carbon, we have 6 carbon 12. Here number of proton is 6 and number of neutron is also 6. But as we go higher, we consider higher elements, so the number of protons is less in comparison to number of neutrons. We have also studied in nuclear stability that the stability curve shifts towards the neutron number, not to the proton number. So the number of neutrons are increasing in comparison to the number of protons. Also, we have seen that the zone of stability is also lying towards the neutron. So we say that there is some contribution to the excess neutrons. So these excess neutrons goes into a state of high kinetic energy. They assume the states of higher kinetic energy. So the binding energy term will be proportional to the excess neutrons. So we have to see how many excess neutrons are there. So the excess neutron will be the factor of n minus z. Supposingly there are n neutrons and there are z protons. So the number of excess neutrons will be n minus z. And the binding energy will also be depending upon the volume of the nucleus in which this excess neutrons are lying. So the binding energy is proportional to n minus z and to the volume in which the excess neutrons are there. So that is n minus z upon a. So n minus z represents the excess number of neutrons over protons, and n minus z upon a is the fractional volume of the nucleus in which this excess neutrons are present. So since these excess neutrons is giving a state of highly unstable state, it is also creating instability and it is in the higher kinetic energy. So this term has also to be deducted from the total binding energy. So there comes again a negative sign. So if we remove the proportionality sign, we get a fourth constant of proportionality, A4, which can also be calculated by the empirical formulas. So B4 is minus A4 n minus z whole square upon a. And since we know that n is equal to a minus of z, so we can put instead of n, a minus z, we get a minus 2z whole square upon a.
So it also reduces. So this asymmetric energy term is also reducing the total binding energy. So that is why there is a negative sign. And this is also called the correction term. So if we plot the graph, if we plot a graph between the binding energy per nucleon and the number of nucleons, so we see that here we have the first term, this A1. This is due to the volume energy term. So since B upon A is independent of A, so it is a constant value. So for volume term, we see that this is a straight line, that B upon A is independent of A and there is a constant line. But if we see that B upon A versus your surface energy term, so the B upon A term is increasing. Okay, so this surface energy term is increasing. The increase is not linear, it is an exponential increase. But if we see the Coulombic, so here what is there? There is A raised to power minus 4 by 3. And A minus 4 by 3 means A into A 1 by 3. And this term is in the denominator. So B by A is inversely proportional to A, number of nucleon, means it is decreasing. So your Coulomb energy term is decreasing with respect to A. So B by A is decreasing with respect to A. And if we see the asymmetric term, the B upon A we get, we see that this is B upon A term is here decreasing, but the decrease is very small. Okay, it is rather a very constant one. At a wider range, it is assuming a constant value and then slowly it is decreasing. So the last contribution comes for the pairing energy term. We had already seen that if the pairs of neutron and protons for even combination, that if there are even number of protons and even number of neutrons, the number of stable nucleus were 165. But for the combination of even neutron and odd proton, or odd neutron and even proton, the number of the stable nuclei were 57, 53. But for the combination of odd proton and odd neutron, the number of stable nuclei were only 6. So the stable nucleus factor also contributed to the pairing energy term. So it depends whether the nucleus is having even number of protons or even number of, or any combination of neutron and protons. So this pairing energy term contributed to the binding energy. So the binding energy, the fifth factor of the binding energy for due to the pairing of the protons and neutrons, was proportional to a factor of A raised to power minus 3 by 4. So this, when we remove the concept of proportionality, we got a concept of proportionality, that is A5. And this value could take either the positive value, negative value or zero value. So it depended upon that whether we have combination of even protons, even neutrons. If the combination was even proton, even neutron, so we have written for A5 upon A3 by 4, this is delta. So for even proton, even neutron, we say that the binding energy would be positive, because the number of stable nucleus for even proton and neutron were very high. So this would add up to the binding energy term. But if we have odd proton and odd neutron combination, very less stable nucleus were there, so the binding energy would have a negative sign. So this is minus delta. But for even proton, odd neutron, or for odd proton, even neutron, there was no factor, nothing was contributing towards the binding energy. So binding energy took the value of 0. So for pairing energy, we have terms corresponding to positive delta, negative delta and 0. So we had to add up all these 5 components of the binding energy to calculate the total binding energy. So when we added, we got a formula. That formula was named as Weizsäcker semi-empirical binding energy formula. So this formula was B is equal to A1 into A minus A2 into A into raised to power 2 by 3 minus A3 Z into Z minus 1 upon A raised to power 1 by 3 minus A4 A minus 2 Z ka whole square upon A. And the fifth term was plus minus 0 A5 upon A raised to power 3 by 4. Where all these five constants A's were calculated
and these were found out to be the values of A1 was taking the value of 14 mega electron volt, A2 is 13 mega electron volt, A3 is 0.60 mega electron volt, A4 took the value of 19 mega electron volt, and A5 was 35 mega electron volts. So substituting the values of A's and putting the value of Z and A, we know for a particular nucleus of particular element, we could calculate the binding energy of that nucleus or that element. So if we know the value of B and we know that the mass of the nucleus could be found by this relation, that is ZMP plus NMN minus of B, substituting all the five contributions of B and substituting all these values in this, we could calculate the mass. So the mass of the nucleus was given by ZMP plus A minus ZMN minus A1A plus A2A raised to power 2 by 3 plus A3Z square A raised to power minus 1 by 3 plus A4A minus 2Z square A minus 1 plus minus of delta, where in this case plus sign was for odd and negative sign was for even, because due to the negative of subtracting the binding energy, this positive negative has been interchanged. So positive contribution here is for odd and negative is for even. So this formula what we got for the mass of the nucleus was called the semi-empirical mass formula. So for this we could calculate the masses of 200 stable nuclei, and this is very important relation that was calculated, and it gave many answers to many queries. So I hope that you have understood how to calculate your semi-empirical mass formulas, and thank you.